In closing, John McManus, president of the John Birch Society. We've got Patrice O'Neill, comedian and actor, coming on the show in about 8 minutes. The Council on Foreign Relations, 10, 15 years ago, wouldn't go on the news. Limbaugh would say it didn't exist. Now he says they have no power. But now he's having to admit they're setting up global government. So is Glenn Beck. We're seeing what we talk about become mainstream because it's emerging. But now suddenly every other speaker on Fox and CNN and MSNBC is Council on Foreign Relations. And Geithner comes out. Obama says, oh, no, we're not going to have a global currency in his press conference 2 nights ago. But then Geithner comes out yesterday and says, oh, yes, we're looking at that. Who is the CFR? What is the global currency? What control does this give them? Why is it the brass ring they're after?
After World War One, the United States Senate voted no to membership in the League of Nations. It was going to be world government. The United States Senate said no. And thank goodness they did back then. So at that point, then President Wilson's chief advisor, his guy who lived in the White House, Edward Mandel House, got together with British counterparts. They set up organizations in their country to promote the goal of world government. The British formed the Royal Institute for International Affairs. The Americans formed the Council on Foreign Relations. House, Wilson's chief advisor, had written his own book, and he said he was working for socialism as dreamed of by Karl Marx. Now, obviously, one of his disciples was Wilson. Another of his disciples was a man named Franklin Roosevelt, whose mother gave him a copy of House's book in 1920. And when Roosevelt won the nomination of the Democrat Party in 1932 on a conservative platform, he headed back east, went right past his own home, and went right up to Massachusetts to visit Edward Mandel House at his summer home. The first man he went to see when he got the nomination was a man who said he was working for socialism as dreamed of by Karl Marx. And so Roosevelt did what House wasn't able to get accomplished, including getting the United States into the United Nations. So this is it. The Council on Foreign Relations has been promoting world government ever since it started. They said so in their magazine for years. We flushed them out over the years, pointing attention to them, and now they're going around saying, oh, we're just a think tank. We just have people. So who goes to speak to them? Well, Bernanke did a week ago. Geithner went yesterday. Everybody who comes to the United States, Gordon Brown from England came to this country. Where did he go to speak? The Council on Foreign Relations, and so on. So people got to know about this. We have a book called The Shadows of Power that explains it and explains it well. I see you're advertising Ed Griffin's book, The Creature from Jekyll Island. That's the history, I guess that's the graduate course about what the Federal Reserve is all about. So all of that, American people have to know. Don't rely on your normal media for the information that you need. You're not going to get it. You have to go to the alternative media. And that's what we are. John Birch Society, if it's anything, is an alternative medium of information. Alex Jones is an alternative medium of information. You keep putting it out, we'll keep putting it out, and we'll get American people, enough of them, to say, finally, okay, we got to stop this, right?
Absolutely. Do you agree, sir, that the New World Order is attempting to finally bring in open world government?
Absolutely.
And that they're in super high gear right now?
Yes, they are. I've been frightened over the years by developments. I'm more frightened about this economic problem than I have been for it. But I'm not saying it's over. No, in no way. It can be stopped.
Well, Kissinger always said they would use a great crisis to bring in their New World Order. And we have hundreds of quotes published in their own publications saying they want one world government. And then all over the newsstands, it's like we're in Mussolini's Italy or something, or Mao's China. And here in Austin, Texas, there's pictures and photos of Obama in most of the stores, and it's like he's being worshipped as a savior, and he bills himself as anti-banker, anti-establishment, and he's
not.
Well, absolutely. But I mean, here's this magazine. This is Environmental Magazine. One of my guys was at Whole Foods today buying some food, and this is on the newsstand. President for the planet. Obama sets a new green agenda. This is nothing but neo-feudalism to shut down the free market because the bankers
want
competition.
Well, you got your magazine. I got mine. This is the New American. I'm the publisher of it, and this is an issue that we had. Obama, shock and awe economics, and it goes into it in detail. This is the kind of information we put out all the time. I got a team of writers and some researchers that I think are just tops, and they do a great job. They don't just say that this is happening. They quote these people. They show exactly what they've said. They show where it's going to lead and so forth. So we want people to take a look at the New American Magazine in addition to everything else we do.
Absolutely. Give out the website for folks, the John
Birch Society. Well, jbs.org. That's very easy. And then you can call and get those DVDs, the Overview of America, Dollars and Cents, 1-800-JBS-USA1. They only cost a buck a piece, but you have to pay a shipping and handling charge. So get a few and share them. And a lot of people do, and they say, wow, how come I never knew this? How come nobody ever told me before? And so, well, Alex, we're grateful to be able to come and visit with you. I've been on with your show before, but I've never met you. I've never been in person, and you do exist, and so do I. And we'll probably try to do this again.
Absolutely. One more time before you leave, as president of the John Birch Society, John McManus, tell the listeners again where you're speaking.
Speaking tonight, Thursday, at the Embassy Suites in San Antonio, and then on Friday night at the Richardson Civic Center right outside Dallas in Richardson, Texas. Anybody's welcome. We're glad to have you. You can come. You can ask questions after the program's over. I always stay around, and a lot of people come up and have questions. And we sell the books, and we sell the magazines. We sell the DVDs, and it's all going
to
be
good. One last question I forgot to ask you. You guys have written a lot about the militarization of law enforcement, the open announcement of NORTHCOM. They want to put 20,000 regular combat troops on the streets of America. Under presidential decision directive, it basically makes the president all-powerful during an emergency. And they're now openly saying that they may use troops against the American people. Can you speak to that briefly?
Well, that would be a total violation of American law, the Posse Comitatus Act, and so many other things. The military is not supposed to be the power, the plaything of the president, and that's what it's become. You look into the Constitution, and it says the Congress shall have power to fund an army, but it has to be every second year they have to review it. The Congress shall have the power to create a navy, and there's no restriction. Why? Well, every second year, you got to review the army because they are fearful of a standing army. They're fearful of government power having control over the military. And the founding fathers were very fearful of that, and everybody else should be. We don't want the military to be the plaything of the president, and that's what it's become. Not only to possibly enforce government edicts here within our country, but look at all over the world. You know, we have troops in 130 different nations. Thousands and thousands of troops all over the world. John Birch Society has a simple solution. Bring them home. And if you can get them home before midnight, that'd be soon enough.
Well, it's true conservatism, true pro-sovereignty, and we would definitely, I think, be down the tubes already inside the New World Order if it wasn't for you guys. And I really appreciate you coming in. Again, in closing, what would the Founding Fathers think of the police state, the military being used on the streets, this whole unfolding system?
They'd say no, absolutely not. Constitution says we don't go to war unless there's a declaration of war, and there hasn't been one since December of 1941 when we declared war in Japan because they bombed us at Pearl Harbor. Right? We didn't declare war in Germany. They declared war on us because they had a pact with Germany. But we didn't declare war in Korea. It's still there. It has never been settled. We still got 45,000 troops in Korea. We didn't declare war in Vietnam. We didn't declare war in Desert Storm. We didn't declare war against Afghanistan or against Iraq. And we shouldn't have been there in the first place. But anyhow,
all right,
the Constitution. Back to the Constitution.
Absolutely. John McManus, president of the JBS. Thanks for coming in.
My pleasure. Right.
Pleasure to meet you. I appreciate you being here.
It's been a delight.
You bet. Good luck on the tour.
Thank you.